Welcome to Grab and Go Info. Categorical entity embedding extracts the embedding layers of categorical variables from a neural network model and uses numeric vectors to represent the properties of the categorical values. It is usually used on categorical variables with high cardinalities. For example, a marketing company can create categorical entity embedding for different campaigns to represent the characteristics using vectors and use those vectors to understand the similarities between campaigns or put the vectors as features into different machine learning models to improve the model performance. In this tutorial, Python TensorFlow Keras is used to create categorical entity embeddings of Airbnb neighborhood data. We will talk about how to do data processing for categorical entity embedding, how to build a neural network model with entity embedding, how to extract the categorical embedding layers, how to use categorical entity embedding in other machine learning models. Let's get started. In step 1, we will install and import Python libraries. Firstly, let's install the Matplotlib version 3.4.2. Matplotlib version 3.4.2 is installed because a Matplotlib version later than 3.4.0 has a new functionality of adding labels to seaborne visualization. After the installation and restarting of the runtime, we can import the libraries. Pandas and NumPy are imported for data processing. Train test split is for train test splitting. Random forest regressor is for building the random forest model. Seaborne and Matplotlib are for visualization. Plot model and image are for visualizing neural network model structures. TensorFlow and early stopping are for the neural network model. The second step is to download and read the dataset. A website called Inside Airbnb had the Airbnb data publicly available for research. We use the listing data for Washington, D.C. for this analysis, but the website provides other data for other locations around the world. Please follow these steps to download the data. Go to http://insiderm.com/get-the-data. Scroll down the page until you see the section called Washington, D.C., District of Columbia, United States. Click the blue file name listings.csv to download the data. Copy the downloaded file listings.csv to your project folder. Note that Inside Airbnb generally provides quarterly data for the past 12 months, but users can make a data request for historical data of a longer time range if needed. Those who are using Google Colab for this analysis need to mount Google Drive to read the dataset. You can ignore the code below if you are not using Google Colab. Drive.mount is used to mount to the Google Drive so the Colab notebook can access the data on the Google Drive. os.chdir is used to change the default directory on Google Drive. I suggest setting the default directory to the project folder. pwd is used to print the current working directory. Please check out Google Colab tutorial for beginners for details about using Google Colab for data science projects. The listing data has the property information aggregated at the listing ID level. We will build a simple model to predict the listing price, and the following columns will be read from the dataset. ID is the unique ID for the Airbnb listing. Neighborhood is the neighborhood name where the listing is located. Room type is the type of the room. It can be the entire house, a room in a house, etc. Price is the daily price in local currency. Washington, D.C. is in the United States, so the currency for the price is US dollars. Minimum nights is the listing's minimum number of nights for the stay. Number of reviews is the total number of reviews for the listing. Reviews per month is the average number of reviews per month. Calculated host listings count is the total number of listings that the host has in Washington, D.C. Availability 365 is the availability of the listing in the next 365 days. The listing can be unavailable because of the guest booking or the host blocking. Number of reviews LTM is the number of reviews in the last 12 months. More details can be found in the Inside Airbnb Data Dictionary. Using .info, we can see that the dataset has 6,473 records, and 10 columns. 2 out of the 10 columns are categorical, and the 2 categorical columns are neighborhood and room type. Most of the columns do not have missing data. Only the variable reviews per month has missing data and needs missing imputation. In step 3, we will work on data processing. For the missing values in the variable reviews per month, I suspect that the missing values are generated because there are no reviews for the listing. To confirm this assumption, I filtered the data frame and kept only the records with missing values. Then I checked the values for the variable number of reviews. We can see that all the listings with missing values have zero reviews. Therefore, we need to impute the missing values to zeros. The price range shows that the minimum price is zero and the maximum price is 10,000. We removed the outlier prices and only kept the listings with a daily price greater than $20 and less than $1,000. The visualization for the price data shows that all the outliers are removed. The variable room type has 4 values: private room, entire home or apartment, shared room, and hotel room. Entire home or apartment is the most popular room type, and private room is the second most popular room type. Because the number of categories is small for room type, we will not do entity embeddings. Instead, we will use getDummies to create a dummy variable with 0 and 1 values for each category. After the dummy variables are created, we append them to the data frame DF and drop the column room type. After the data processing, we have 6,411 records in 13 columns. There are no missing values in the dataset, and neighborhood is the only categorical variable. Using .unique, we can confirm that the dataset is unique at the listing ID level. The count plot of neighborhood shows that the number of listings in a neighborhood ranges from 12 to 557. The Capitol Hill, Lincoln Park neighborhood has the highest number of listings. In step 4, we will do the train test split for the model. X has all the features for the model prediction. .iloc is used to select the features starting the second column and exclude the ID variable. .iloc create a new variable that refers to the same memory as the original data frame DF. Changing the new data frame variable can alter the original data frame. Therefore, we use .copy to create a new copy so X and DF use separate memories that do not affect each other. Y is the target variable. We are predicting the daily listing prices, so the column price is used as the target. X and Y are passed in the train test split to create the training and testing datasets. Test size equals 0.2 means that 80% of the data are used for training and 20% of the data are used for testing. Random state makes the train test split results reproducible. After the train test split, the training dataset has 5,128 records and 11 columns, and the testing dataset has 1,283 records. In step 5, we will do the categorical label encoding for the neighborhood variable. Firstly, two empty lists are created, one for the training data and the other for the test data. Next, an empty dictionary called CatEncoder is created. This dictionary will be used to save the label encodings for the categorical variable neighborhood. After that, all the unique values for neighborhood are extracted and saved in a variable called UniqueCat. There are 39 unique neighborhoods in the training dataset. Then, we loop through each neighborhood and assign an integer to the neighborhood. Finally, the CAT encoder is printed out and we can see that each neighborhood is a key and each key has an integer as a value. There are 39 elements in the dictionary, corresponding to the 39 unique neighborhoods. The neighborhood column is mapped to the integers using the CAT encoder, and the values are appended to the list for the training and testing dataset separately. We can see that the list for the training and testing dataset now has arrays of numbers representing the neighborhoods. In step 6, we will build a model with categorical entity embedding. Firstly, let's create the embedding layer using the embedding function. Input dim is the number of unique values for the categorical column. In this example, it is the number of unique neighborhood. Output dim is the dimension of the embedding output. How to decide this number? The authors of the entity embedding paper mentioned that it is a hyperparameter value to tune with the range of 1 to the number of categories minus 1. The authors propose two general guidelines. If the number of aspects to describe the entities can be estimated, we can use that as the output dim. More complex entities usually need more output dimensions. For example, neighborhood can be described by population density, distance to major tour locations, convenience level, number of Airbnb listings, and safety index, so we set 5 as the number of output dimensions. If the number of aspects to describe the entities cannot be estimated, then start with the highest possible number of dimensions, which is the number of categories minus 1 for the hyperparameter tuning. Name gives a name for the layer. The input dimension of the categorical variable is defined by the input function. Input is used to instantiate a Keras tensor. Shape equals 1 comma indicates that the expected input will be a one-dimensional vector. Reshape changed the output from three-dimensional to two-dimensional. Recall that X-train has 11 columns, one categorical column neighborhood and 10 numerical columns. Next, let's append numerical values to the training and testing list. We can see that the training and the testing input datasets have two arrays each. The first array contains the categorical encoders, and the second array contains the numerical variable values. The input dimension of the numeric variables is defined by instantiating a Keras tensor using the input function. Shape equals the length of the numeric columns indicates that the expected input dimension is the same as the number of numeric columns. There is no embedding layers for the numeric values, so mNumeric is the same as input numeric. We can see that the output dimension for the numeric variables is 10. The input Keras tensors for both the categorical and the numeric variables are put in a list called input data. Input data shows that the first element has an input dimension of 1 and the second element has an input dimension of 10. Similarly, the output Keras tensors for both the categorical and the numeric variables are put in a list called mData. mData shows that the first element has an output dimension of 5 and the second element has an output dimension of 10. The categorical variable neighborhood has a dimension of 5 because we specified the embedding dimension to be 5 in the embedding layer. The numeric variables have a dimension of 10 because there are 10 numeric columns. Using the concatenate function, the Keras tensors in the list mData are concatenated together. The output Keras tensor has a dimension of 15, which is the sum of the dimension of the two tensors in the list. The concatenated data is passed in the dense layer of the model. The first three dense layers have 15 neurons, 8 neurons, and 4 neurons separately. They all have ReLU as the activation function. The output layer has 1 neuron, and the activation function is linear because the target variable price is a continuous variable. Then the input data and outputs are grouped into an object using the model function. Inputs takes in the inputs of the model. It can be a Keras input object or a list of Keras input objects. As the Keras documentation pointed out, only dictionaries, lists, and tuples of input tensors are supported. Nested inputs such as a list of lists or a dictionary of dictionaries are not supported. Outputs takes in the outputs of the model. Name is the name of the model. We gave our model the name of entity embedding model Keras. We can print out the model details using the summary function. The summary of the model entity embedding model Keras has four columns. The first column is layer. It has the layer names with the layer type in the parenthesis. The system automatically gives each layer a name if the user did not specify the layer name. Out of the 9 layer names, only embedding cat is user defined. All the other names are auto-assigned. The type in the parentheses describes the type of the corresponding layer. We can see that our model has the input layer, the embedding layer, the reshape layer, the concatenate layer, and the dense layer. The second column is output shape. None means the batch size has not been fixed. It can be any number of samples. The numbers are the number of neurons for the dense layers and the number of columns for other layers. The third column is parameter number. It is the number of parameters needs to be estimated. The embedding cat layer has 195 parameters. It is calculated using 39 unique neighborhoods multiplied by the embedding dimension of 5. The layer dense has 160 parameters. It is calculated using 15 input values from the concatenate layer multiplied by the 10 neurons in dense 1, and plus 10 bias values from dense 1. The layer dense 1 has 55 parameters. It is calculated using 10 input values from the dense layer multiplied by the 5 neurons in dense 1, and plus 5 bias values from dense 1. The layer dense 2 has 12 parameters. It is calculated using 5 input values from the dense 1 layer multiplied by the 2 neurons in dense 2, and plus 2 bias values from dense 2. The last layer dense 3 has 3 parameters. It is calculated using 2 input values from the dense 2 layer multiplied by the 1 neuron in dense 3, and plus 1 bias value from dense 3. The input layer, reshape layer, and concatenate layer do not have parameters to estimate. The fourth column is connected to, indicating the input layer for the current layer. The two input layers, input 1 and input 2, do not have any value for this column. The embedding cat layer is connected to input 1. The reshape layer is connected to the embedding cat layer. The concatenate layer is connected to both the embedding cat layer and the input 2 layer. The embedding cat layer has the categorical entity embeddings, and the input 2 layer has the numeric inputs. The layer dense is connected to the concatenate layer, and each of the following dense layers is connected to the previous dense layer. At the bottom of the summary table, the numbers of total parameters, trainable parameters, and non-trainable parameters are listed. Total parameters is the total number of parameters for the model, and it is the sum of all the parameter numbers from each layer. Trainable parameterisms is the number of trainable parameters that are trained using backpropagation. All the parameters in this model are trainable parameters. Non-trainable parameters is the number of parameters that are not trained using backpropagation. Our model does not have any non-trainable params. We can add trainable equals false to a dense layer to change it from trainable to non-trainable if needed. The neural network model structure can be represented by a graph and saved as a picture. From the graph, we can see that one categorical variable is the input for the embedding layer, and the embedding output 5 variables. The 5 variables are concatenated with the 10 numeric variables, and a total of 15 variables are the inputs for the dense layers. When compiling the model, we set mean squared error as loss, Adam as the optimizer, and me as metrics. Early stopping is used to prevent overfitting and save computing resources. Monitor equals val loss means that the validation loss will be monitored. Mode can take the value of min, max, or auto. Min means the training stops if the metric stops decreasing. Max means the training stops if the metric stops increasing. Auto means the stop criterion is inferred from the name of the monitored metric. Verbose controls whether to print out messages. It has two values, 0 and 1. 0 means do not print out any message, and 1 means that a message will be printed when the early stopping happens. Patience is the threshold number of epochs without improvement. Restore best weights equals true means that the model weights with the best monitored value will be stored. When fitting the model, we pass in the training dataset and use the testing dataset as the validation data. One epoch is when all the training dataset is used once. Epochs equals 1000 means the model goes through all the training datasets a maximum of 1000 times. Batch size equals 64 means that 64 samples will be used to update the weights and biases each time. Because we have 5128 records in the training dataset, it will be divided into 80 batches with 64 samples, and one batch with 8 samples. Verbose equals 1 means that we will print out some messages during the model training process. We pass in the early stopping variable to callbacks. The early stopping happened at epoch 883 with the training mean absolute error of 68 and validation loss of 69. In step 7, we will check the model performance. The first visualization plots the loss change over epochs. We set the loss to the mean squared error in the model. Loss represents the mean squared error in the chart. We can see that both the training and the validation loss decrease with the epochs. Validation has a higher loss than the training dataset. This may suggest model overfitting. We will leave the topic of correcting overfitting for a neural network model to a separate tutorial. The second visualization plots the mean absolute error over epochs. We can see that both the training and the validation mean absolute error decrease with the epochs. Validation has a slightly higher mean absolute error than the training dataset. Using dot predict, we make predictions on the testing dataset. The output is two-dimensional, so flatten is used to change the prediction to one-dimensional. The scatter plot of the predicted price versus the actual price shows that a higher predicted price corresponds to a higher actual price in general. But there are some listings with much higher actual prices than the predicted prices. To quantify the difference between the actual price and the predicted price, we calculated a variable called model error and used it to calculate the mean squared error, the root mean squared error, the mean absolute error, r squared, and the mean absolute percentage error. The same metrics can be calculated using the functions from the sklearn.metrics library. We can see that the sklearn library and the manual calculation produce the same results. In step 8, we will extract the categorical embeddings. The weights are extracted from the embedding layer and saved in a data frame. We can see that the data frame has 39 rows, each row representing one unique neighborhood. There are 6 columns in the data frame. The first column is the encoded categorical index. The other 5 columns are the embeddings. To append the neighborhood name to the embedding data frame, we put the categorical encoder dictionary into a data frame and merge the data frame with the embedding data frame on the categorical index. In step 9, we will save the entity embedding results. We can use .csv to save the entity embedding results to a CSV file. Index equals false means that the index of the data frame will not be saved. The embedding model can be saved in HDF5 format using .save. In the future, the model can be loaded using the load model function. In step 10, we will build a random forest model as a baseline model to compare with the neural network model. The model used all the 10 numeric features and the scatterplot of actual versus predicted values generally aligns. Similar to the neural network model, some listings have much higher listing actual prices than the predicted prices. The random forest model performance metrics are similar to the neural network model metrics. In step 11, we will talk about how to use the categorical entity embeddings in other machine learning models. The random forest model will be used as an example, and other models can follow the same process. To use the entity embeddings in a model, we treat the embeddings as the 5 features for each neighborhood and appended them to the training and testing dataset separately. We can see that after adding the embedding features, both the training dataset and the testing dataset have 15 columns. Using the new feature list with embeddings to train the same random forest model, we can get the new predicted results for the testing dataset. The dots in the scatter plot are more scattered than the base model, indicating that this model may have a worse performance. The model performance metrics confirm that the random forest model with embeddings performs worse than the baseline model. The values are worse across all the metrics. This tells us that adding categorical entity embeddings does not always improve the model's performance. Sometimes it just adds noise to the model and makes the model performance worse. So it is always a good idea to have a baseline model before adding entity embeddings. One possible reason for the worse performance of the random forest model with embedding is the small dataset for training the embeddings. There are not enough information in the dataset for the model to learn meaningful embeddings. When millions of records are used to train the embeddings in my work, the baseline XGBoost model performance was improved slightly. The entity embedding paper has 2 tables showing the model performance improvement across 4 different machine learning algorithms. What's your experience with using entity embedding? Did it improve the model's performance? Please let me know in the comments. If you have made it this far, you probably find the information in this tutorial helpful. Please click the like button and subscribe to the channel to get notified when I publish new videos like this. To learn more about deep learning models, please click the YouTube playlist on the screen now. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video.